The spill happened on April 29th of 2011, and the Canadian federal election happened, it was May 1st, and the community wasn't released the information until after the federal election, and so therefore we couldn't inform the media of how big the spill was until after the federal election. And I love everything about this land. I love the way that the trees sound in the wind right now. I love how you can see all the stars in the Milky Way at night. I love how the grass is able to grow and not be manicured like it is in cities. I love how there's wildlife out here. I love how dogs can roam free. I love how there's barely any fences. I love how this is the homeland of where I was born and where my ancestors are buried. There's a lot of things I love about being from this land.
Is this pristine nature that you're talking about as pristine now?
Not at all. I mean, it's still a really beautiful place to be day to day. But if you go further and further back where all the cut lines are, where all the industry is, I mean, we're completely surrounded by pipelines and places where they're extracting conventional or unconventional tar sands. There's also fracking, there's logging happening. So there's immense resource extraction happening all around us. There has been, you know, numerous health concerns and also impacts to the land throughout the past 3 decades as they've been extracting resources from our homelands. When I was a child, there was even blockades happening in the 80s to block out the oil companies that were coming through. And then even more recently, you know, there's been massive oil spills that have been happening to the traditional territory, one that was as big as 44.5 million liters or 28,000 barrels. Knowing that my family couldn't breathe and their eyes were burning and they're feeling nauseous, like, these are the types of impacts that community members and communities have when they're so close to resource extraction.
Mm-hmm. At what moment in your life did you realize that this was going to be your mission, to draw attention to and to ultimately stop these industries?
Probably about a decade ago, I've been working on resource extraction. I decided to go back to do my master's in environmental studies, and my research topic was tar sands. And, you know, this was over 8 years ago now, and like, just the amount of information that I was uncovering and being like, why doesn't my family know this? Why don't people in Alberta know this? Why don't most Canadians know this? And this is like supposed to be, you know, one of the energy, a way to become an energy superpower. You know, it was just like inconceivable to me, knowing when you actually look, have it down on paper and knowing the immense cost that there is, it's just, it's really hard to stomach. And for me, that was like the onset of, I need to do something, like I need to tell people about this. And so that's why I decided to join the climate and energy campaign with Greenpeace that had a tar sands campaign, because for me that was going into universities, going into high schools, doing like teach-ins really across Canada and North America into the States and in Europe, because it's, you know, all of this energy system is related to the financing that comes out of Europe. Or America, or the corporations, you know, the 20 plus corporations that are in the tar sands. When I started doing media tours and investor tours in the tar sands, then I realized, wow, this would never happen in Denmark. This would never happen in Sweden. Like, you know, there was a lot of shock that a lot of people had, and a lot of international media were just like, I can't believe this is happening in Canada, a place that we think is environmentalist, very, you know, environmental friendly. And Canadian governments had so much land to destroy that we're kind of reaching the ends of that.
So you mentioned that part of your work is addressing misconceptions about what is a very controlled, in terms of like the discussion, controlled industry. What have been some of the biggest misconceptions that you are constantly coming up against?
I would say, you know, once you start really uncovering research and reports, you realize how destructive it actually is. We're using natural gas to produce the tar sands. We're burning 4 times as much, you know, for the underground mining type of it. We're producing immense amounts of carbon emissions, which is now creating the tar sands as the fastest growing source of greenhouse gas emissions for Canada. There's all of these facts that are not presented as facts in mainstream media, and that's a pretty frustrating thing because a lot of people think that they can get, you know, the majority of the information that they need to know to make an informed decision from media, and they can't. They have to do the research because the government is actually not giving them the research that they need. And even the Auditor General, like who actually does do, you know, cross checks and balances, the government is also saying these things. But most Canadians don't read those reports. They're kind of going on their day to day, and some people are really busy, and climate change isn't their number one concern, but I think that's slowly changing. We have forest fires burning across this country out of control. People realize that, oh, we're in drought. California only has 1 year left of water. Or in Alberta, we are, you know, in a state of emergencies for agricultural farmers. So I think people can no longer just kind of turn the other way.
Mm-hmm. Well, and another fact is that there are communities of people living not 2-3 kilometers away from some of these sites. Why don't you think people are learning about these kinds of humanitarian problems?
A lot of people aren't exposed to what we're exposed to here in Northern Alberta. We're at the site of resource extraction, so we see it firsthand. But there's a disconnect between rural communities and urban centers where a lot of the information stays separate, you know, and not a lot of the information isn't communicated through our educational system. So, I mean, even for me, as by the time I went to high school in the city, we weren't learning about what was happening in the tar sands. All we knew was it was called the rigs. And the only reason why I knew it was called the rigs is because I had friends that were older than me that were just out of high school that were going to work on the rigs, and that was the only topic point. Like, it wasn't that, oh man, these are really intense, or man, these are really, you know. I knew that they were dangerous because one of my friends was in a truck and flipped and died. So I know, you know, a lot of these places aren't safe, but there's not a discussion of, not only is it not safe for workers, it's not safe for their health, and it's not safe for the environment, it's not safe for the climate. So, you know, these discussion points need to be expanded, and they haven't been, and now they slowly are, with more and more people going out to rallies or stating their concern in, like, you know, the flawed National Energy Board applications through some of the pipelines. So I think people are becoming more aware of it. Social media has definitely helped, because obviously through mainstream it's somewhat censored and they only can say so much, and it's just a way for people to share information more freely. So I think that's also helped.
Mm-hmm. You told me a story last night about the spill that occurred in 2011. Could you tell me a little bit about, you know, what happened, but then also what the response was like from both the industries and the government?
Yeah, I mean, there was no emergency response plan for the community, so my family was left wondering if they should stay in the community, if pregnant women should be in the community, small children, you know. They couldn't breathe, their eyes were burning, they were feeling nauseous, they had to close the school down just over there for a week and a half because the teachers didn't even feel safe to take care of the students because they were feeling so ill because of the noxious and volatile gases that were being emitted from the oil spill. You know, they're wafting over into the community because it was so close. And yet the community had no idea. You know, one of the only reasons why I knew it was oil that had spilled was because I was Googling it, and we just found a business website informing industry that a pipeline had shut down. So, you know, because it would affect their business earnings and makings. So it wasn't about informing the community that, hey, FYI, you're beside one of the biggest oil spills in Alberta's history, which the community found out 5 days after the spill, which is not sufficient enough time to know that you're beside something that massive and to make an informed decision if you should be leaving the community, because the government was basically putting my family and the community at risk because they refused to admit that the problem was that big. The spill happened April 29th of 2011, and the Canadian federal election happened, it was May 1st, and the community wasn't released the information until after the federal election, and so therefore we couldn't inform the media of how big the spill was until after the federal election. Obviously, during elections, they don't want a big, massive oil spill to be running because that's, you know, Harper's pro-tar sands, pro-fracking, pro-Arctic drilling, pro-oil and gas agenda. It shows, you know, shows that there's a flaw in how communities would, you know, would respond, because that's something that they're being put at direct risk.
Well, and a lot of these communities our First Nations communities. You know, this is something that's very systemic and has really spanned, you know, more than a century. What do you think needs to happen in order to reconcile just this terrible reality that's happened in the last century or more?
Well, I think true reconciliation actually looks like more than just saying sorry. All people, you know, through the treaties that were created or through the history that's developed over the past century, is that Canadian people have also benefited from this type of resource extraction and also like what's happened to First Nations people. So there's, you know, it's actually about making better alliances between communities, you know, learning about the true history of what's actually happened on this land, as opposed to what's solely in textbooks. That's pretty dismal, you know, to think that a lot of young people don't know the real history and a lot of older generations don't. So it creates this divide. When you don't understand, you don't know, you don't trust, you don't know how to connect. And I think when you do understand history, when you do understand the impacts of colonialism, then you can start to figure out how to make amends. But until you really understand the true impacts of it, it's really hard for you to act from a place of compassion. Because I think it's been a lot in the past, a lot of victim blaming, right? Oh, these communities are the way that they are because it's their fault. We didn't have the right to vote until 1960. We didn't have the right to retain a lawyer until 1960. We didn't, you know, a lot of our people that went off to fight in the war lost their status as Indigenous people. A lot of Native women that married non-Native men lost their status. If some First Nation person wanted to go and get their university degree, they would have to lose their status, you know? So it's like you're choosing between your homeland, your community, your family, and, you know, trying to better yourself, you know, become more assimilated in mainstream society, when it actually has a detrimental impact to who you are as an Indigenous person. So there's a lot of costs that were associated with leaving your community, but staying in your community meant poverty, meant rations, meant you had to have a land pass to leave the community, that Indian agents were taking away your children forcibly and you would be jailed, you know. So there's all of these histories that a lot of our non-Native counterparts in Canada don't know the reality of, like how our families were starved, they were raped, they were beaten. This is a very integral part of history of Canada, and it's something that I think, you know, needs to be put in any textbook for social studies.
For people who have found that place where they are able to understand and as much as they're able to empathize and wish to become an ally, what advice would you give them to make sure that when they come with a open heart and good intentions, that they're actually able to make a positive difference and not impose any kind of ideas or ways of working on people?
Our communities had traditional governance systems and they functioned very well. You know, they had shared decision-making powers that were matriarchal, and I think a lot of times people have these ways of, you know, thinking that you can go into a community and somehow help a community, when there also exists, you know, solutions in the community. You know, really learning the history before you go into that community. These stories and these histories are very traumatizing. You know, like I know some of my aunties and uncles, they don't want to talk about residential schools. It's a very harsh reality that they had to live through. Why would they want to live through it again by talking about it? Sometimes it can be healing, sometimes it can be really triggering. And yeah, figuring out how to work side by side instead of going in and saying, I have the solution. Like, I think the solar project is a good example of the solutions that we can find in communities. Like, I was kind of just sick of waiting on the government or industry to do the solar insulation for us. I just wanted to do it myself, with support of the community, obviously. But there's also a lot of resiliency in the sense that we're able to create beautiful things.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I'd love to continue talking about this project. Could you tell me about what some of the processes were to get this underway, and how you were able to make this quite large project happen?
Yeah, well, the first was starting in the community, having a meeting actually last summer, just over there, and just to talk about, do people want to see solar in the community? Is this something that people would be interested in seeing happen in Little Buffalo? And then from there, it was saying, okay, people want this. People are excited about it. People want to see it happen. People want to understand how it works. People understand the value of it, that we can create energy from the sun as opposed to digging into the earth. So that was the next step, was fundraising for the project and saying, like, you know, contacting people like Bullfrog Power and saying, would you be interested in fundraising something like this, fundraising community in the tar sands? And by having the support of Bullfrog, then we were able to approach other funders like Honor the Earth, and then people like even Jane Fonda, when I told her about the project we were setting up this summer, I didn't even ask her, she just donated to the project. It's pretty exciting when you get support like that from outside the community and then lend the support into the community.
Mm-hmm. Could you speak more about how the community itself has helped make this project a reality?
Yeah, so we're working with community members on site. So all of the stuff you've seen so far is all community members going up. People in the community support it. I'm really excited. Kids are really excited when they hear about it. You know, it's like, what? We can create electricity from the sun? That's just, it's such a novel idea. And I think it's so important for young people to know there is hope out there. We don't have to just be stuck in fossil fuel dependent system. We can transition to a renewable system. And I really hope that it inspires the young people to look at working in the solar industry in the future. Because I think if we have that in the community, it's proof that that's happening around the world.
What do you see as the role of your generation and the generation that's right below you in terms of making this happen?
I see my role as kind of like an instigator, like lighting the flames, like, or reigniting the flames, because our community's had a long history of resistance. For me, coming from this history of resistance, it's my responsibility to continue that my grandparents didn't, you know, die in vain, that they will be proud of me.
Your work with Greenpeace has a lot to do with ending, like, these extractive industries. What are you trying to build in its place?
For me, it's actually like showing what the solutions are as opposed to just using it as a talking point. You know, I got to the point where I was like, I can't just always talk about the problems. I need to talk about what the solutions are, what the yes is to the no. And so for me, it was saying, like, you know what, I'm just gonna put up solar in my home community because I want to see the young people benefit from the work that I'm doing. This work I'm dedicating, like, years and years of my life to transition to a better way of life for our communities and for my community, but people actually need to see what that looks like. It's not just about blockading, it is, but it's also about showing what solutions are. And I think for me, that's trying to live the solution in a way that makes sense to people, because then people will actually see it.
Are you proud of yourself for the work that you've been doing?
I mean, I feel very, I think it's like, it's for us, it's like a responsibility. You know, they talk about treaty rights, but it's actually about responsibilities to the land. It's actually about ensuring that what I was able to witness as a child and experience as a child is there for my future children and my future children's children. So for me, it's not about being proud. You know, I'm very grateful for the life that I've had, but I'm also feel like it's an immense responsibility. I feel like it's just a way to make my grandparents proud. You know, they were very concerned about the land. They loved the land. They were a part of the land. They lived off the land. They didn't even speak English. Their whole worldview was Cree. And so for me, being able to know them and see them and know what it meant to be a Nihiao person, that's my responsibility to continue our way of life, which is actually more in alignment with what sustainable values are. You know, I think a lot of people are actually turning towards Indigenous communities and people realizing that the reason why North America was pristine, it wasn't by accident, it was through stewardship of the land. It was through our relationship with Mother Earth.